Hello, everyone. I'm very pleased to welcome Sri Piyush Goyal, the Minister of Railways and the Minister of Commerce and Industry of the Government of India. Honorable Minister, we're very pleased to have you join us. And before we begin our discussion, I do want to, this is the first occasion I have to personally congratulate you on receiving the very prestigious Carnot Prize from the University of Pennsylvania, which is a great recognition of your achievements and accomplishments. So many congratulations. And thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you very much, Dr. Yagin. In fact, we in India always look forward to this engagement. This is the fourth year that we are having this along with you. And your leadership in the emerging energy world is something that Prime Minister Modi, my colleague Dharmendra Pradhan, and I have witnessed firsthand and learned a lot from the wonderful ideas that you present every time that we get a chance to meet. And I must thank the support of your organization, your personal goodwill for this prize, which clearly is a reflection of the way India is engaging with the new energy transition and with clean energy. I think this was only a recognition of the work that Prime Minister Modi and the entire country is doing towards the new age energy world.
Yeah, I think so. And I think the fact that we have this India Energy Forum and the deep engagement of you and so many other people, and you've been a very important part of it over these last 4 years. So it really is a statement of how the world is changing and how India is changing and how the policies of Prime Minister Modi, the impact they're having. But of course, we are now in a difficult period. India has been hard hit like the rest of the world by COVID-19. You have your fingers on the economy of India. How is the recovery going from your point of view?
Well, clearly, India embarked on probably the strictest lockdown seen anywhere in the world. And during the months of end March to about June, we saw the economy almost come to a standstill, except for very essential movement of commodities and food grains and fertilizer. Other than the medical equipment working, the medical systems working, pharmaceutical and important export commitments being met, by and large, the country was in a complete lockdown. While that did have its toll on the economy, but Prime Minister Modi was very clear that if we can save lives, we can always rebuild the economy. But should we be under stress of saving the economy at the cost of a large number of lives lost, I think that would be an irretrievable loss. His strategy also was to prepare the nation, prepare our indigenous capacity to fight the COVID pandemic. I'm sure you are aware, Professor, when the COVID pandemic hit India, we had one lab which could test 250 samples a day in the entire country. Today, we are doing 1.5 million tests, from 250 to 1.5 million tests every day, which has helped us really get a grip on what the COVID story has panned out, where it's having its major impact, and what remedial measures we as a nation need to take. Other than that, we were able to ramp up our capacity in terms of ICU beds, our COVID care centers, capacity to manufacture personal protective equipment, masks, which have become, I think, our uniform today. We were able to ensure adequate availability of ventilators, oxygen. And through this period, the Prime Minister was always one step ahead of the curve. I remember a call I got in early March, when India barely had about 400-500 cases. And he was all the time studying what happened in past pandemics, what happened in past problems that the world has faced. And he's telling me, Piyush, do you think we can convert our railway coaches into COVID care centers? It hit me like a thunderbolt. Railways are supposed to transport passengers. And where did he get this idea from? But when we sat down to study it, we realized how brilliant it was. Given the vast span of India, 600,000 villages, it would have been near impossible to take medical facilities into the interiors of India or move the patients from the villages to the city hospitals in the event of a wide outburst of COVID in our villages. But converting our railway coaches into COVID care isolation wards, we could actually move them to the village, since we have stations across the length and breadth of the country, and provide them COVID care at their doorstep. Similarly, oxygen was something which nobody knew could have become such a big chaos, could have been so much of a problem. But somewhere in end of March or April, he put me on the job that watch out for the oxygen consumption and availability of oxygen. And since then, we've been monitoring it every week, to the extent that today we have a complete mapping of oxygen availability, demand from various centers, and how we will meet increased requirement of oxygen at short notice. So I think this effort of the lockdown, while it cost us on the economy, helped us prepare the nation to meet this challenge. And now we are ramping back to normalcy very, very quickly. I can share some data points. In the month of September, the railways moved 15% more freight than we moved in September 2019. Our exports are 5% up in September 2020 compared to September 19. Power consumption is actually up by 5.5% in September over the last year. The wheels of the economy are fast coming back to normal. Unlock is almost complete through the length and breadth of the country. People are taking the precautions in terms of masks, in terms of 6 feet distance. In Hindi, we call it do gaz ki duri, a distance of 2 yards between two people when you engage with them. And of course, personal hygiene. So on the one hand, we are saving livelihoods. On the other hand, we continue our effort to save lives and therefore have one of the lowest mortality rate and the fastest recovery rate in the world. Thank you.
Well, what you say about September is quite extraordinary. First, of course, how India manages in a country of 1.3 billion people is really amazing. And I think a story that is not as well known in the rest of the world. I think we can all learn from it. And the second thing is that I wanted to mention our IHS Market Purchasing Managers Index bears out what you're saying. It's now at the highest level it's been in 8.5 years, and in September shows a real, very dramatic increase. What industries are leading the recovery?
Well, I think all the core sector has ramped back to normal very fast. As I said, energy, our power demand, also our petroleum products, gas, all of these are almost back to normalcy or a few percentage points up and down. Power is up, petroleum products are slightly down. Steel is back to normal. Cement is near normal, which leads us to believe that the construction and infrastructure projects have come back to normalcy in a big measure. Construction activity is almost back to normal with steel, cement, sand, gravel, all those products in full measure. Fast-moving consumer goods have also started picking up. Automobiles is at its best in the last 2 years, particularly in the rural India, where two-wheelers, tractors, and now even passenger cars are doing well. On commercial vehicles, we are still down, and that's a sector the government is focusing on and will address soon, the commercial vehicle sector. Obviously, as in the rest of the world, we have challenges around certain service sectors like hospitality, tourism, aviation. And I believe in these sectors, we are at about 50 to 60% level of the pre-COVID days. And it will take another 6 to 8 months before we come back to normal. But these are sectors which on the GDP are relatively small in India, relative to the Western world, where they contribute in a very big way.
So all of this is happening. You still have COVID cases in the country, but you're able to manage the COVID and yet at the same time bring back the economy. Can you say a little more about how you do both of those things at the same time?
Well, I think gradually we are coming to terms with COVID. Being a young population, as we assess the number of casualties to COVID, we realize that A, we still have amongst the lowest mortality rates. It's about 1.5% of the total COVID cases. And at the same time, we also have a situation where, by and large, except for those with comorbidities, people are recovering very fast. Most cases are asymptomatic. Our recovery rate is nearly 90% now. The number of active cases are under 1 million. And the daily case count has also fallen from about 100,000 a day, about 3 or 4 weeks ago, to 36,000 a day currently. Now, for a country of 1.3 billion people, 36,000 per day, many of whom are asymptomatic, don't require hospitalization, don't require oxygen or ventilator support. I think by and large, we are on very, very safe territory on COVID, but we are not letting our hair down. The Prime Minister is monitoring it personally. In fact, he was on television only last week, appealing to the people of India that we celebrate our festivals. We've just had one festival 2 days back, Dussehra. We're going to have Diwali, where we're going to have a lot of joy and festivities across the country, and then Eid and Christmas and New Year. The Prime Minister is taken very seriously. He leads from the front. And I think the people are celebrating festivals in a very subdued manner, a very, very sober manner, maintaining the three protocols of 6 feet distance, mask, and high level of personal hygiene. Thank you.
Yes, exactly. As you said, the new uniform. So it really with that discipline. Well, let me ask you about India's relationship with the global economy. A couple of weeks ago, you gave a speech in which you talked about, quoting the Prime Minister, moving from command and control to plug and play. And just what are you doing and what's your focus on integrating India in terms of bringing in additional foreign direct investment?
Professor Jürgen, we recognize that in this globalized world, India will have to engage in a much larger way with the rest of the world. While we are looking at Atmanirbhar Bharat, the self-reliant India, it is often misunderstood to be a program to close India's doors. Whereas the reality is, we wish to open our doors wider. We actually wish to engage with the world in a much bigger way, but with cost competitive and quality products. Over the years, we realized that India has not focused as much on creating scale and high quality products, which would give us a larger share of the world market. We are now looking at addressing problems of quality so that our products get recognized for high quality, for being affordable and at a bigger value proposition. And for that, the government, academia, and the private sector are working together. We are addressing the challenges of each sector item by item. We are ensuring that we handhold sectors which need short-term support before they can fly on their own. And at the same time, we are studying all the laws, the regulations around the industry in India to kind of demystify the business environment, bring in more simple and predictable regulatory practices, decriminalize laws so that they are simpler to follow. And we in the Ministry of Commerce and Industry are working with the states and local bodies to try and make it easier to get licenses, permissions, approvals, and the reporting formats to make it easier for businesses to focus on their business and make regulation less intimidating. So I personally am driving an initiative to make everything on one platform, somewhat like you have in the United States. When you apply for college admission, you have the common application form. It gives all the basic data. And then you have those annexures that each college wants in terms of an essay or two, asking you about your personality or your likes or your career plans. Similarly, we are looking at a single platform where common data would be available for all, and we would have the rollouts into drop-down menus where individual departments could run through their approval process. And I hope a person sitting in the United States will be able to buy land in India, get all his approvals, hire people, and maybe even manage his operations sitting in his home in America or in his office in America. So we are trying to use the best of technologies and integrate India with the rest of the world.
Well, we appreciate that because I think, as you know, in IHS Market, we have over 3,000 employees in India, and we try and run it very much as an integrated company. So your common application form is a very good concept. Let me ask you a little more about self-reliant. The biggest study that I'm working on with my colleague Atul Arya at IHS Market is what we call new supply chains for a net zero carbon economy. And I know India is, and you're giving a lot of thought to supply chains, and I'd be very interested how you're thinking about supply chains and your focus on supply chains is evolving, because it's something that we're giving a lot of attention to.
Professor, very clearly, every country cannot be the best in every product. There are certain competitive and comparative advantages that are unique to each country. And that is why supply chains, global supply chains, have emerged and they've helped create value propositions in terms of products and services. We recognize that. And therefore, we believe that we will have to make it much simpler for companies and global supply chains to integrate with India in terms of access of goods and services, both inward and outward. We are working with the Customs Department to ensure seamless flow of goods into the country and out of the country. We are working on logistics costs, which has been a detriment to India's trade competitiveness. We have a new division on logistics, which is integrating the shipping lines, railways, airways, our inland waterways, road transport. We are trying to work and see how we can bring down logistics costs, which is an essential component of global supply chains and India's own role in that. We are also looking at ways and means to ensure long-term policies so that global supply chains don't get hassled with frequent policy changes. And we are also looking at opening up the economy in a much bigger way. You saw some recent reform measures on farm, on the agricultural reforms, on defense reforms, on space reforms, mining reforms, capital market and financial sector reforms, also labor reforms. So this government is looking at COVID as a crisis, which we need to convert to an opportunity and prepare India to be an integral part of the world.
Do you think one of the lessons too, I think, is that the world needs more diversified supply chains, that they've been a little too concentrated?
That sometimes becomes a very sensitive subject, but right. I cannot agree with you more. Very clearly, over the years, I think in the rush to look at every cent, we landed up placing large parts of our economies at very high level of dependence on certain geographies. And I believe that now the world has recognized that we need to have diversified supply chains, but also trusted partners. And I use that phrase, trusted partners, with great responsibility, because the world wants fair trade, the world wants transparent trading systems, the world wants equal and equitable access and reciprocity. It can't be that large companies are thrown out of certain countries and not allowed to even enter. I mean, you have countries which are not allowed Facebook and e-commerce companies, or even something like chat rooms to come in from other parts of the world. Whereas India has allowed all sorts of engagement and has allowed international companies to work in India, prosper in India, grow in India, expand, leveraging 1.3 billion people market. I think the world today is seeing in India a trusted and open economy. And therefore, I believe India has an important role to play in the diversified supply chains that many companies are looking for. May I also mention, Dr. Professor, one more data point that will interest you. Even through the lockdown, during March, April, May, and June, we fulfilled every single service commitment to companies around the world. So our services export was over 90%, even during the lockdown. So we did not let down any company worldwide. And everybody's operations who have back office in India or who are dependent on Indian operations, you will check across the world, they had 100% uptime, because Indian government and the private sector worked together to ensure uninterrupted supply of services, even in the worst period of the lockdown.
Well, we certainly see that India is going to have a much bigger role to play in the world of supply chains and diversification for the reasons you've said. I think we have time for me to ask you just one last question, because I know you got to get back to work. But railways, your other responsibility, target 100% electrification by 2023, net zero emissions by 2030. How is it going?
It's going brilliantly, Professor. And I must say, you and your colleagues have been an inspiration in our work. The recognition that we got from friends like you pushes us to perform even better. Again, I can share with you certain data points. We have about 65,000 route kilometers in India. We are already 40,000 under electrification. And the balance, 24,000, is going on at a fast pace. By December 2023, in the next 40 months, we'll be completely electrified in the country. I'd be happy to give you the way we've ramped it up. From 2009 to 14, we were doing about, at an average, 800 kilometers of electrification of routes per year. In the last month, in the last year, 2018-19, we did 5,000 plus kilometers. In 1920, we actually completed 5,200, but the last 1,000 was under testing by the authorities, the Commissioner of Rail Safety. So we got certification of only 4,200 until 22nd March. The rest of the 1,000 we got post the lockdown, once we opened up. But we were able to complete about 5,000. So in the next 3.5 years, we hope to do about 6,000 every year. And we are very confident we will be the world's first large railway. We have about 65,000 kilometers, route kilometers, and 120,000 line kilometers in this vast country. Everything will be electrified. Going forward, we started the process of preparing railways to become net zero railway, zero carbon emission. We have already embarked on 1 gigawatt of solar panels along the railway lines, which will feed in directly to the railways. We'll expand that to about 3 gigawatt, which will feed in the day hours. We are also using land we have around the country to set up about 20 gigawatt of clean energy sources, which will finally take care of our entire railway electricity requirement. Of course, we may have to bank some of it in the grid for our nighttime requirement, unless with the collective effort of you and the rest of the world, storage becomes more affordable so that we can store our own energy and use it in the evening and nighttime. So I'm really looking forward to offer to the world the world's first 100% electrified railway and the world's first net zero 100% driven by clean and renewable energy railway. We will seek your continued support and blessings in our program. The Prime Minister is committed to it. The people of India are committed to it.
Well, that is, Honorable Minister, that is an incredible achievement and in what's been accomplished in the last few years. And as you say, the scale of accomplishing it for the future will really be a world record to do that and a major contribution. Honorable Minister, we thank you for spending this time with us. We know the schedule is very busy, and everybody is very pleased to hear both about what you're describing in terms of the reforms and the opening and the moving forward of the Indian economy, and the very good news you have about economic recovery now, not something in the future, but already happening with at the same time controlling the virus. So congratulations to you and your colleagues, and thank you very much for spending the time with us. It's a pleasure again to see you and look forward to seeing you next year in New Delhi. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Yagi, and deeply appreciate this opportunity to engage with you, even though virtually this year. We will look forward to meeting you soon in Delhi. As we speak, we have the 2+2 dialogue going on with the United States simultaneously in Delhi. And I do hope the lines will open up and we'll start traveling again soon. My prayers and best wishes for your good health and your near and dear ones, Professor. Thank you very much.
Namaskar. Thank you. Thank you very much.